Jennifer Montgomery is a supervisor in Placer County. We're delighted that she's on our LGC board. She's been involved with the Seattle Business Council. She's been involved with the Sugar Bowl Ski Resort. And did you just find yesterday that you actually have an opponent to this year's primary? So we're not happy about that. We know that other board members are happier than you are, Jennifer, but nonetheless, you're going to do just fine, and you're going to lead the first panel on this morning's session. Jennifer, welcome.
Thank you, Jake, and thank you everyone for coming out this morning. And Jake, thanks for friending me on Facebook. I appreciate that. If you haven't friended Jake, look him up. He's the hardest working man on Facebook. I do want to thank the local government commission for asking me to be the moderator on this today. The topic, for those of you who may not have reviewed your agenda, is, let me turn this over so I make sure I get it exactly correct, valuing ecosystem services, paying for natural resource projects. Those two things are incredibly important to me as a county supervisor who does represent the largely forested portion of Placer County. And the speakers that we've got today are absolutely incredible. I'm hoping that our third speaker will show up in time to present. But I wanted to just give you a little bit of a quote that I found on the internet that really kind of gets to this issue. And if I can open my iPad, life would be much simpler. Let's try that again. Okay. Ecosystem valuation can be a difficult and controversial task, and economists have often been criticized for trying to put a price tag on nature. However, agencies in charge of protecting and managing natural resources must often make difficult spending decisions that involve trade-offs in allocating resources. I think those of you who are elected or appointed can completely understand the meaning behind those two sentences. So what I'm hoping that we get to today with our three speakers is a better understanding of how we tackle this controversial task of ecosystem valuation, but also how we move to protecting and managing those resources by implementing specific projects. Our speakers today, we have three. We have David Shabazian. He's the program manager of the Sacramento Area Council of Governments. He is in charge of SACOG's Rural Urban Connection Strategy, which strives to enhance rural economic and environmental sustainability. He's pioneered tools and strategies that help stakeholders make better informed decisions. The RUCS, which is the Rural Urban Connection Strategy, was recognized as a top 25 program in Harvard's 2015 Innovations in America Government Competition. And David was raised on a farm in California Central Valley. David, why don't you come forward and have a seat? Also joining us today is Louis Blumberg, who I had the opportunity to meet this morning, and he and I have a lot to follow up on, apparently. Louis is the director of the California Climate Change Program at the Nature Conservancy. He has been with the Nature Conservancy since 2004. Since the year 2000, he has been directly involved in developing climate policy here in California, working with a variety of governments and non-government partners in the development of forest carbon protocols, now in use in California's carbon market. He is also involved with establishing a public policy program to promote climate resilience at the local, regional, and state scales. He also brought, and I'm sure he will talk about this a little bit today, a report, the Climate Action Through Conservation Project, that the Nature Conservancy and, I want to say Sonoma? Sonoma County Open Space and Agricultural Preservation District collaborated on, so I'm looking forward to hearing that. Louis, if you would please come forward and join us, that would be great. And then I'm going to introduce her, even though she's not here yet, just so when she does arrive, you have a little bit of a background on her. Laurie Wayburn is the co-founder and president of the Pacific Forest Trust. Laurie is an accomplished forest and conservation innovator who advises policymakers at the state, regional, national, and international level. She pioneers new approaches to develop sustainable resource economies using her experience in the fields of conservation, ecosystem services, and sustainability. She is a preeminent authority on the climate and ecosystem benefits of forests. She leads efforts enacting climate change policies that unite conservation and sustainable management with market-based approaches. And we also hope that she has a good sense of direction and arrives in time with them. Okay, having said that, we tasked each of our speakers a little bit with a particular message. And they may or may not have actually followed up on what we asked them to do, but I want to start with David. We had asked David to discuss SACOG's rural urban connection strategy and other strategies that a region can deploy to increase economic, environmental vitality of rural and urban regions. So I'm going to hand this over to David and let him take it away.
I'm at the end of a cold here, so it's all coming down the back of my throat. So excuse me if I sound a little gravel here. Well, thank you for having me here this morning. I think that, can you hear me okay, by the way? I tend to project, but not always. I like starting with that tagline, because I think it says a lot about what we're up to with the Rural Urban Connection Strategy. If you think about planning, it's usually about cities. And I'm gonna talk a little bit about that because, is that our other speaker? Regional planning usually is about a collection of cities. It's a collection of urban areas or urbanizing areas. That is usually rolled up as a regional plan. And what we did at SACOG is we said, that is part of the equation. We have a region that is 4.2 million acres. About 12 or 13% of that is urbanized. The rest of it is rural land. And yet we're only planning for about 12 or 13% for the most part. Now, it's interesting because the population is the inverse of that. You have about 85% of our population living on 13 or 14% of the land. And so, guess what? Funding and all the action follows the population. And so, we're not unlike most places in the rest of the country. We have concentrated on urban planning as a regional planning organization. Back in 2004, when we, 2008, when we did our new transportation plan, we were also at the culmination of a lot of our regional stakeholders saying, hey, what about us? You've done a lot of really good work at looking at urban planning, but you haven't talked at all about what's happening in your rural spaces. And in fact, the question came up, what does green mean on that map? So we have definitions for all of the different kinds of land use in an urban space, but we don't define what green means on that map. And so what we did is we flipped it on its head and we said, well, we are a region, that means that we're urban and rural, and so we should map out what is in the rural space. And that's what we found. We found at a parcel level, all the crops being grown in our region, we're up to about 150 crops that are grown in our region. And we mapped it out and we said, this is our de facto general plan for agriculture and forestry in our region. Now that's a different perspective. That's a good picture of a region. Urban and rural parts and how do they work together, and that's the genesis of the rural-urban connection strategy. Coming to the economy part of that, we said, look, land use is a reflection of economic development decisions being made by jurisdictions and their landholders, and these are efforts to make money. All right, so the same thing is happening on the rural side of the equation. These are farmers making decisions about how to use their land in order to make money. So we need to figure out what are kind of profit maximizing solutions that help farmers stay in business and in fact create kind of a de facto growth boundary, because farmers making money are usually farmers that stay farming. Farmers who aren't making money are usually farmers who end up as developers or handing their land over to developers. That's been the pattern in the Central Valley for, what, the last 50 years. And so we were kind of tackling this growth issue in our region from both sides of the line now. Good, smart growth policies to hem in the footprint. And then coming from the other side, okay, what are good strategies that keeps farmers in business, keeps that land economically viable, and really creates us together as an economically viable region. So we broke down the project into five topic areas. These are kind of overarching. First is land use and conservation. You got to understand your policies and your planning that governs that land that you're talking about. Infrastructure. Okay, nothing happens without things like sewer and water and roads within cities. You need roads in rural areas, but you also need things like irrigation systems and labor, and you need still land in supply. Those are all, that's all infrastructure for agriculture, as well as processing, aggregation, distribution, all that infrastructure that goes along with the value chain in food. We need to look at the market opportunities. Same thing happens on the urban side of the equation. What is the market for this housing type? What's the market for retail space? What's the market for industrial land? Okay, go on the other side of the equation, or the other side of the line. What's the market for fruits and vegetables and grains and hay and livestock? And use that as a way to then figure out as a region, where do we need to start putting our energies in tackling, getting into these markets and figuring out if they can actually make us more money. Forest management. About 28% of our region is forested. And I'm not going to go into forestry in a lot of depth in this presentation, mainly because we haven't rolled up our sleeves in the same way that we have in the valley looking at agriculture as we have for forestry. But suffice it to say, I don't think anyone here has missed the fire frequency and severity that continues to increase in our state and, you know, throughout the West, and that those management practices that can really attack that are also good for our watershed. And linking the watershed and the production of water is, I think, going to become a very, very important part of the state's solution to its water problems, and also a way to link the consumers down the hill to the forest managers up the hill, and what we're doing together, again, as a region to manage those resources. And then finally, regulations, which is the thread that runs through everything. And so these are the topic areas that we have been digging into and trying to kind of break down this landscape into these parts so that people understand when we're talking about things, how they all fit together. Excuse me. So when we're looking at these economic opportunities and what the landscape can do in our region, we have to kind of take stock of what we've got. What are our opportunities, but what are our challenges of getting there? So again, we start with the markets. We have export markets that are on fire, right? I mean, California is a huge export state. I can't remember what percentage of our total ag production goes out of the state now, but it's a very large percent. In our region, it's 98% of our products leave the region. So we are exporting products. But there's also a very hot sector, which is this local food. And so those are the two market opportunities that we're really interested in, understanding better and figuring out where we can make more money as a region, and link our land use and economic development around those market opportunities. So we've got rising demand for food, especially California-grown product. The trends in healthy eating are, I think, just getting started. And when the USDA continues to come out with its advisories on how to, the food pyramid is completely shaken up now. It's a lot more fruits and vegetables and nuts, and all of that we can do in California. We have great natural assets. We have the climate. We have the soil. We have the water. There's an opportunity in value add. That's really where the action is in the food system. Only 16 cents on the dollar goes to the farmer. The rest of it is in the food system. So the more of the food system we have in our region, the more money we're going to make off of that food dollar that you all spend every day. And so that's the opportunity part. What's the challenge? Okay, well, lack of infrastructure. We've been losing our infrastructure, our ag-related infrastructure over the last 30 years. And so that value add is leaving the region. Water and labor supply, of course, we're in a drought. Doesn't seem like it right now, but we're long-term trends are drought. So we're gonna have to grapple with water supply. And labor supply. I mean, Mexican farmers can't even get enough labor for their fields. So how do you think we're doing in California? Big, big problem. The regulatory environment is not helping very much. And then, of course, climate change is out there, and we're still not sure how that's manifesting, but it's looking like the models are fairly accurate. So all of this comes together, again, asking the question, how do we position our region? How do we attract investment? Now, I'm building this up as, you know, this sounds like just economic development, but I want you to keep in mind that what I'm talking about is a way to show value in the landscape and food production. But the other part of that tagline that I showed you at the beginning was what's the sustainability play here as well? And what we're operating on is the premise is that if we can show ways to make money right away in farming, the long-term play is that land will stay open and we get the ecosystem services out of that land. And then the next step would be, okay, well then what do we do in terms of valuing those ecosystem services? So I will get to that, but I want to make sure you don't think I'm going off somewhere different than what we're supposed to be talking about. So these are our assets. I mentioned soil and water. We've still got it. It's not, especially our groundwater is not as good as it used to be, but we still have groundwater in our region. And in some parts of our region, we have a lot. We have, you know, 3 and 4 and 5 generations farming in our region, and they are excellent stewards of the land, and so we really need to tap into that. Of course, we have UC Davis in our backyard, and then again, we see rising values. Even last year, in the fourth year of a drought, California set record farm gate values. So we have figured out how to make money without too much water, and that's a really important nuance to all this, is that there are ways to make more money on less water. And the way we know that is because we run scenarios. We look at different cropping patterns and figure out how can we make more money on less water, or how can we still have crops in the ground without the labor supply. We have to run scenarios to figure out whether those work or not. And so that's what our toolkit is really built around, is a scenario tool. And we look at these modules on the side, and I'm going to talk more about other modules that we're starting to use. But look at the market opportunities, export markets, local markets, those are the drivers, those are inputs to the model. We use the economics back behind our crop map for producing that food, and we come up with scenario results. These are just some basic ones, but these are the key ones that we use. What's the return on investment? So first question is, are farmers making money on these scenarios? How much water do we need to implement that scenario? Trucking, what's the impact on the roadways? Are we actually increasing truck trips, which is, Larry probably wouldn't like that kind of result. And then labor demand, okay, again. Labor, if we don't have it, then the scenario doesn't really make any sense. So these are ways for us to start comparing these different conditions in the future and seeing, are they realistic, can we get there, and what do we have to do to get to where we want to be. It works something like this. Here's a small example, 2,000 acres of alfalfa converted to prunes. That may sound kind of silly, but prunes are actually, they pulled out too many trees. So now they're having to put them back in the ground because the processors are in short supply. Prices have gone up. So guess what? You put trees back in the ground. The model does this. It says, okay, well, let's compare those two scenarios. So once your orchards become mature, you've paid off your debt, your value on that 2,000 acres goes up by $2 million, your return annually goes up by $500,000, you're actually using less water, but you need more labor. And you're actually putting fewer truck trips on the road. You harvest alfalfa in our region about 5 times a year. You harvest prunes once. So those trucks are coming out to the field once instead of 5 times. So what's the impact on the region? That's 2,000 acres. We're seeing more and more trees go in the ground. I got the 2-minute mark. Oh, I have lots of slides to go through here.
I'll cut you a little slide.
Okay, thanks. So that's just 2,000 acres. What if we continue to do this across the region? What's the impact on the entire region? And I told you, we can compare scenarios. So here's, I'm not gonna go through each of these, I promise, but I do wanna show you a couple of things that you can learn when you start to tee up a whole range of scenarios. In this example, the tight relationship between the value of your production and how much labor you need to produce that food, pretty tight relationship, and then also you can make more money on less water. Okay, so these scenarios help us start telling stories about what it is we can do as a region to make more money, to, or if that's not your objective, you know, what are we going after here? And then just to show you kind of map-wise how they compare, this is our base condition in Yuba County. This is a condition where they put in nothing but specialty crops, fruits, nuts, and vegetables. The return goes up substantially, goes up 5 times, but so does the labor, okay? And then in this case, because they have so much rice and alfalfa, the water demand actually goes down, and yet they get a 5-fold increase in profit, but their water demand actually goes down. Okay, so more money, less water. That should be our mantra, more money, less water. And then that's linked to processing, and I'm not gonna go through this in too much detail, but suffice it to say, we have been studying processing because that's where the action is. We have found that mid-scale processing actually is very profitable. League of Food Processors tells us you will not see a large processor come to California anymore. They just can't afford to do it anymore. We've also then tied that processing and production to truck trips. Larry likes this result, which is that processing is very important. We've shown that, and I'm running out of time, so I'll just tell you, I'll give you the punchline. If you don't have processing in your region, but you're still growing products that are going to market and those trucks get on the road, what we found is that implementation of AB 32 actually goes backwards. If we continue to, in this example, grow tomatoes in Yolo County, but we no longer have a tomato processor, those trucks get on the road, they have emissions related to that, those emissions actually, they are more than what you gain if you close down the facility. Okay, so go past that. Land use policies, I mentioned this earlier. The edge is actually, it's a flashpoint. This conflict between urban and rural is real. And we had a full board session last year with my board talking just about this issue of this interface between urban and rural. So those policies are important to manage that edge and figure out ways that you can still produce food and fiber and not disrupt the residents on the other side of the line and vice versa. And then finally, what are your policies that are keeping your land in production, maximizing what farmers can do, conserving that land? There's a whole spectrum of policies. I could do a whole presentation just on policies around land use and agriculture. Tying together urban and rural, if you do good urban planning, our forecast, and this is actually old, this needs to be updated, but our forecast was that looking backwards, we used to use 333 acres for every 1,000 people added to the region. We're down to 42 acres for every 1,000 people, and that's through implementing good urban growth policies. This is not SACOG kind of waving its hands and saying, hey, this is a good idea. This is our jurisdiction saying this is what we're gonna do. And so this is a reflection of doing a lot of work at coaching people on what are good policies, what's good for your city, and those finally kind of sinking in and being reflected back to us in these numbers. I think I don't need to tell this story other than as your density increases, your greenhouse, your emissions, weekly passenger vehicle CO2 emissions are reduced substantially. So we're down 20% if we go to alternative 3 in our land use scenario, which is a lot of densification. Okay, so I'm gonna hopefully do this in 2 minutes. How's that? So all of this links back to ecosystem services. Now again, I mentioned earlier that keeping the land open is our primary objective and that we are kind of riding the economic horse, which is if we can find ways that people can make money, more money off of their open land, then we're going to get from that also the ecosystem services that go along with that. And all of this is really rolling up into that last bullet, which is this idea of working landscapes, getting production out of the land, but also getting ecosystem services out of the land and trying to find that balance or that trade-off. So we are starting to dig in. We received funding on a settlement for this corridor in our region where an environmental group sued this JPA. They won. That money came to SACOG to start doing in the trenches, working landscapes analyses along this corridor, looking at how do we get not only habitat conservation or preservation out of the mitigation for this, but other services like groundwater recharge, for example, which is very, very important in our region right now. And so we have that funding, we're getting the project started, we're working with UC Davis, and we're employing models that we're going to have talk to our models. So we're going to start talking back and forth between conservation models and this land use model that we have that I showed you earlier. We have funding to do groundwater management studies, so we're looking specifically at how do you bank water so you can grow crops, and specifically these high-valued specialty crops. And so we're starting to work with our water districts to figure out areas where we can recharge the aquifer through flood irrigation. Believe it or not, flood irrigation is making a comeback. And I kind of say that jokingly, but this really is how we are going to manage our water basins, is through flooding certain areas with highly porous soils that will take that water down quickly so we can bring it back up somewhere else. And so that schematic that I showed you earlier has gotten much different, where we're starting to employ these conservation models, and I'm not going to go through all of these, but they now link in with our crop planning tool. And we'll go all the way back to our crop map so that we have this connection now. It's not just the economics, but it's also the environmental function of the landscape that'll help us start thinking more broadly about what are we doing with our cropland in the region. And then finally, how does that impact our results? And so same thing here, same results, but now we're going to add to it things like greenhouse gas emissions, groundwater recharge potential, habitat potential, and again, ask the question, what's the impact on our region? So I'm sorry I went long, but that's what we're up to at SACOG, and I guess we'll take questions later?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Boy, I don't know about you, but I could probably listen to that all day, and longer than 15 minutes, so I apologize.
No, I'm sorry for going long.
Oh, no worries. Fascinating topic, something that Placer County has been trying to struggle with as well. I'm sure every jurisdiction in here is trying to work on this. Next up, we are going to have Laurie Wayburn, and I introduced you earlier, Laurie, just to save time when you did arrive. We're glad you found us. Welcome. You've got 15 minutes to talk about your presentation today. And after the three presenters have presented their information, I'm going to ask them all to come back up, and then we will have a question and answer session. Lori's got a thumb drive, it looks like, that we need to get loaded, so we will take just a minute on that. I will remind you that Lori is the co-founder and president of the Pacific Forest Trust. She's been using new approaches to develop sustainable resource economies, and she is a preeminent authority on climate and ecosystem benefits of forests. So I'm hoping, as a resident of the forested area of Placer County, that she'll be touching on forests today. I would imagine she would. And it looks like we are just about ready to go. So once this is loaded, Lori, take it away. And thank you. I'm really glad you made it.
Well, I apologize for being late. I had a little bit of a challenge getting up here last night. David actually made a great segue while the PowerPoint is coming out, you got it, which was the linkage here between planning and water and climate change. And what I'm going to talk about today is an initiative around that very topic. Yay! Don't you love it when technology works? So, you know, California, I'm a fifth generation Californian, and when my father first came to Yosemite, he broke into tears. There were less than 6 million people in California at that time. When he was born, there were 2 million people in California, so it kind of gives you a spectrum here. There are very few things that Californians agree on around water. You know, the water is for fighting, whiskey is for drinking, but certainly had its origin here. And remarkably enough, there is one thing in California that I think everybody, or virtually everybody, agrees on. And that's the importance of our watersheds. Oddly enough, we have absolutely no system, process, policy, or agreement for how we deal with that, but we all agree it's important. So this project here, Healthy Watersheds California, is a project that seeks to create the policy foundation enshrining watersheds in our water infrastructure, so that in fact we do have a system and a financial support foundation for integrating watersheds into the water system, even as we do for our built infrastructure as well. And it's a project that has a technical side, which is an assessment I'll briefly show you about. It has a policy side, which is now linked to AB 2480. And it has a financing side, which is bringing an infrastructure approach to watersheds to be able to work with them comprehensively. So we all know that California has a highly centralized system for water production. And roughly, when you look at this, we know it's 5 watersheds supply 80% of the reservoir water in California, and it goes from the north to the south. Within that, we have a very highly developed contractual system for maintaining the red part of this, which is the canals, and actually from the dams on down. But we have no infrastructure system for the watersheds. So we've had kind of a free lunch. Everybody loves a free lunch. The only problem is that the lunch production system is falling apart. And so it's kind of like, oh no, you pay for it, you pay for it, you pay for it. But everybody still wants a free lunch. I think the benefit of the drought and climate change is we recognize that we all kind of have to share for the cost of the free lunch, even as we share the cost of the lunch delivery system. So what we're doing is analyzing these 5 watersheds that feed the Central Valley and state water companies. This is the Feather, the Pitt, the McLeod, the Upper Sac, and the Trinity. And why we're focused on this is because we do have a contractual and legal system for that infrastructure that binds it together. And there's something, many of you who work in contract law are familiar with the whole notion of a repair and maintenance clause. Well, we have those for the CBP and SBP. This is roughly 5 million acres. It is owned roughly half by the federal government or the public and half by non-federal, private and tribal. This region is not only important for those projects today. People were very smart when they selected those specific watersheds because over the last 100 years, that region has remained cooler and wetter than the rest of the state. And this is the data out of the last 100 years. But as climate change advances, and this is thanks to Jim Thorne at UC Davis, it remains cooler and wetter. And so whether you're looking at these measures of the climatic water deficit, whether you're looking at groundwater recharge, and this is under the different ends of the global modeling, global change modeling, whether you're looking at the persistence of the April 1st snowpack, this region is extraordinarily important. So whereas all watersheds are important, this is kind of like the goose that lays the golden egg. And while we need to do a lot of diversification and a lot of different approaches to water security in climate change, we also really need to take care of this particular goose. And there is the opportunity to do that with the kind of structure that we have for the CBP and SBP particularly. So, a key issue for us was redefining the problem. Most people look at watersheds and they say, oh, that's an enhancement issue. That's optional. We said, no, this is part of the infrastructure. It's essential. And if you look at it as essential, you no longer go, gosh, we can rely on bond issues that kind of give you $100,000 for one project here and maybe $1.5 million for another project there. You look at it from the top to the bottom and you say, well, what do we really need to do in these watersheds to put them in a more optimal condition? How do you cost that out? How do you put together a timeline? How do you put together a governance system that will make that operate well? If you do that, you have enhanced water security. So for whatever water we have, it's more reliable. But you also have reasonable expectations of increases in quantity. We'll go through some of those. So I think you're all familiar with these issues that from an external perspective, from the ecosystem perspective, we call these problems, you know, the overly dense, even aged, closed canopy forests that don't allow penetration of snow and water. You're all probably familiar with the fact that when you have a closed canopy and snow hangs up on the top of it, up to 70% of it is lost with evapotranspiration. You don't have the penetration in underneath into the soils where you can get up to 8% greater snow water yield. We have the loss of our wet and dry meadow sponges. That has had a huge impact on metering out the flow. Fragmentation we recognize as a huge issue. I have a couple of very quick slides on change flow regimes. But this last one, the cultural inertia, you know, we don't usually identify that as a problem because we like to objectify our problems. It's something out there we have to deal with. Everybody here in this room is well aware that culture is as much of an issue as these physical processes that we're talking about. And whether that's on the permitting side from the regulatory agencies or it's the permission side from the public, we need to work on. So, restoring more water-rich forests. How many of you have walked out on a misty, cloudy day and had all the water and kind of collect on your face and drip off? That process of condensation, which happens when you have a turbulence in the air, which you create as you walk through it, if you have a multi-story forest with that uneven canopy, you create far more turbulence. You effectively milk fog clouds substantially more. On the coastal side, it can be up to 25% of total effective precipitation. In mountainous areas, it will be more like 20 and sometimes down to 10, but it's a substantial number. So when you start adding up all these little pieces of snow water yield, of increased penetration into the groundwater, of 5 to 25% more water, you add up to an enormous amount more that you can pull into your watersheds. Then you want to hold that water so that you have more groundwater recharge. You want to have it go more slowly through the system so it's cleaner. This is the restoration of wet and dry meadows, which has gotten, wet meadows in particular, has gotten a lot of attention. But the dry meadow restoration is also extraordinarily important in terms of that metering out. We know that fragmentation actually has a really significant impact on watershed function. When you go beyond 10 to 15% of fragmentation in a built environment, you can degrade watershed function in the well over 50%. It's a really remarkable line in that regard. This is another issue that we deal with, is that we know we have this fragmented ownership property boundaries, but it has an even bigger impact in terms of what the landscape looks like and how the watersheds function. So we need to have a system that can provide some kind of overlay through an incentive and agreed upon management set of targets to what that management looks like across boundaries. So that it's not, you know, we think of the checkerboard, but when you look at the landscape itself, it has many other manifestations. So we're looking at putting together a system that has a somewhat more holistic management approach to it. Net-net, what we want to do, recognizing that climate change is impacting our system, and as David said, we are seeing warmer, drier trends, are not going to have a major magic wand and go away. We want to promote resiliency, because we know we're going to have increased precipitation events at higher frequency. We know we're going to continue to have fires. We don't know the type of pests that were coming in, but there are more coming in. So net-net, what do we want to do? It's just like with our own physical bodies. We want to be in better shape so we can be more resilient. Oh, that, by the way, this is Squaw Creek on the McLeod River, and it had had a thinning regime put in along the upland upslopes above the stream. A fire came through, significant burn. First you see the sedimentation coming out after that, and then a year later it's rebounded extraordinarily well. So this is an example of the technical analysis we're doing. It takes the Pitt River, this is actually the largest contributor into the Sacramento, even though the fewest people know about it. And the analysis looks at, well, how much do we need to do here? What really is the condition that we're dealing with in terms of this? So we gathered together all the publicly available data. We did a lot of data crunching and came out with these numbers about what are the acres on the public side that can need thinning and where we can reintroduce fire, because that is part of the National Forest plans, and what on the private side are candidate sites for thinning as well, although we haven't estimated the fire for those areas at all. Done the same thing with the wet and dry meadows. What we're doing with this is kind of putting our arms around what is the scale of the problem that we're trying to address, and therefore, what does it cost? And what is a reasonable projection of how you can roll that out over 5, 10, 15 years, so that you could do that top-to-bottom restoration. And part of course, what you need to do with that is think about, where's the labor force? Are you providing secure jobs? Is there the infrastructure within the counties to support this? The early estimates we've done on the job side is there are about 7,600 jobs that are supported through this. Those are direct, indirect, and induced. For those of you who don't know what induced jobs are, which I didn't know, it doesn't have to do with giving birth. It has to do with supporting, it's the cafes, it's the restaurants, it's the entertainment. So we looked at this and said, okay, there's absolutely no system currently that exists for this on the watershed side, but it does exist in the built infrastructure side, and that's the so-called concession financing model. Now I say so-called, and I put quotes around this because a lot of people go, oh, I don't want to do concession financing, what is that? Because it isn't a very familiar term, but concession financing was developed to help promote a new source of funding other than general obligation bonds on the federal side to promote big infrastructure projects, particularly in transportation. And in the Water Resource Development Act, WRDA, which was approved in 2014, there was a piece called WISDA, the Watershed Infrastructure Financing and Innovation Act. And that was to bring this financing approach to water infrastructure. And bless that federal government and Congress, they put watersheds in there. Amazing. So that one of the categories available for financing was watershed restoration conservation. So we looked at that and said, well, why don't we do that? And that is an approach that has very low cost financing. It's under 3% for large infrastructure projects. And you don't even have to pay for the first 5 years. You don't have any payback on that. So we said, if that's the foundation of this approach, if we can go out and raise funding around that, and we also bring in the new Water Finance Office at EPA, which has a substantial amount of money in it, California alone has over $100 million around that, and we match that with Treasury bonds, revenue bonds, because this is work that is directly related. It's not a general good, it's a very specific good. And you all are familiar with the difference between revenue and general obligation bonds. We can put together the roughly $3 billion that we estimate at this point. That's our big number that we're tearing down from to do this work. And so we've started floating the idea with a number of the so-called impact investment community. There's enormous enthusiasm around that. We've been working with the Forest Service, with a number of the very large private landowners to talk with them about, well, what do you think? Would this work for you? Because it would be a very significant new source of money to be made available. This would then look to be partnered with other public grants, and in particular, the relationship between climate and water, as David talked about. There's a very tight nexus there in terms of wanting to ensure the resiliency and robustness of those watersheds. Those are also a really big forest carbon banks, and the biggest ones writ large because of all the acreage that we have in the sea. And also taking a leaf out of the book for infrastructure financing to have a very transparent system about that. So I don't know if you remember the slides I was showing of the watersheds. You could have a transparent web portal where people can click on and see where it's the work being done, how much is it advanced. So that the folks in Southern California, who are the ones in the end who benefit the most for this, and who have been polled around some of their willingness to pay, but this is not a willingness to pay approach, but they can actually see the work being done. And that has been shown to be highly effective in getting people to say, yeah, I like this approach, we'll do more of it. So this is the pilot. AB 2480 is the first piece of legislation around that. It's one part of a three-legged stool. That bill does two things. It actually enshrines the definition of watersheds as part of our infrastructure, because that is a gray area in water projects right now. It's alluded to, it's talked about, but it's not specifically included. So number one, it includes that in there. And number two, it calls for the development of a comprehensive investment plan for these watersheds. So The work has started in terms of a rollout of that. We'd love to get feedback around this. I will welcome questions. I'm within my 10 seconds here. So this is something where I think we're trying to bring together the threads of working landscapes, because this puts people back to work with a much more secure funding source for that on the landscape. It allows for long-term planning, which businesses need to be able to finance related work. And it really takes a different approach to watersheds and says, these are not just pretty places to visit. They are not the optional program after school. They are core curriculum. Thank you very much.
I have so many questions I want to ask her when we get to the question and answer portion of this. Laurie, thank you. Last but certainly not least, we have Louis Blumberg. Louis, we've asked to spend 15 minutes discussing the opportunities to reduce or sequester greenhouse gas emissions through natural and working lands conservation and management management strategies and funding, very important to us, electeds funding, available potentially through cap and trade. So Louis, come on up and share your best possible knowledge with us.
Good morning. Thank you, Jennifer, and thank you, Kate, for the opportunity to come and speak to you today. Let me find my... Okay. So I'm going to step back, step up, and start global and work down to address all this here that I've been asked to talk about. So last year was the hottest year on record, and it was preceded by the year before, which was the hottest year on record. And you know, we could go on, we could spend the whole time talking about all of these climate impacts that are happening that make us all understand that climate change is real and we have to deal with it. So I'm not going to wallow in that, if you will, because I'm an optimist, and I think there are many reasons to look and see what's going on around climate and feel optimistic. And I want to tell you, I was at the Paris Climate Change Conference there, which was an incredibly exciting place to be and feel that energy. And I think one of the many, many outcomes there that's really encouraging, especially for this audience, is that the Paris Agreement explicitly recognized that local and regional governments have a role to play, and they call that subnational action, and that is folded into the agreement. It's on the page, and that really underscores the realization that ultimately, two thirds or three quarters of the actions necessary to address climate change will come from global governments. And also, when we look here at California, there's reasons to be optimistic as well. So anybody who, is there anybody who does not know what AB 32 stands for, that acronym? Great, we've done a great job, Kate. So California's climate change program, mandated by AB 32, is doing really well. The report on the first compliance period, which ended after 2014, shows that they have a 99.8% compliance. Essentially, one business failed to meet the requirements. And then you can look at the transition that's happening to a low-carbon economy in California. And the economy is growing, emissions are down, funds are being distributed to disadvantaged communities now from the Greenhouse Gas Fund. I'll talk about that a little bit later. So things are looking good. And in Paris, 194 countries came to an agreement. And of those 194 countries, 120 listed emissions reduction from the land sector as one of their strategies to meet their emission reduction pledges. So that's over 50% of the countries are looking to the land sector. But people don't really know, they don't really know how they're going to meet that requirement and get those reductions. So this is the opportunity before us here in California, here with all the work that's been going on, to really help shape that. And so what I'd like to do here is look at ecosystem services through a climate lens. Yeah,
that's on purpose.
So we know that it's not just the transformation of the energy sector and the transportation sectors alone that are necessary to address climate change. We have to do it through our natural and working land sector as well. And so for that, we need to generate some money, and we need to. So I'm looking at ecosystem services here through this climate lens, and I'm talking and advocating for what we call natural climate solutions. They are essential to maintaining healthy human and natural communities. Natural climate solutions are the suite of land and water management activities that address climate change comprehensively, support human needs, and protect nature. And when you use nature to address climate change, it's very interesting. You get all of the three key strategies that are essential. You reduce emissions, you restore carbon back to the earth, and you enhance resilience. And so we are promoting the suite of natural climate solutions and feel that is really a key way to look at this issue. And the goal is to integrate this concept into all of the climate change planning and sustainability plans. And the benefit is when you do that, you capture a whole range of ecosystem services and other benefits. So I would urge you in your local planning and your local decision making, like your climate action plans, your county general plans, that you do this, that you look at ways to quantify changes in carbon stocks that I'm going to talk about later, and integrate natural climate solutions into these plans. And by doing so, you can protect communities, you can enhance resilience, and you'll be able to capture some of the incentive funding that's available. So, just to step back, ecosystem services. So what are they? They're the benefits that people get from ecosystems. And that one area, one action in one place can provide multiple benefits. And it's key to recognize in cities that ecosystem service activities that happen outside the city can also benefit the people within the city. There is a nexus there between rural and urban that ecosystem services really can break down. So what are some of the examples here? These are, if you will, nature-based ecosystem services. Pollination of crops, water quantity, carbon sequestration. We've heard about that already. Regulation of floods, timber, and forage. And I would posit that one of the ecosystem services that is generating money, for which there are markets now, is carbon. And that's in due part because of MAB 32. It's not the only one. You know, we've heard of several different ideas in place now for other ways. Wetland mitigation banking has been around for a while. But this carbon is the one that's really captured the public eye and the policy eye as well. So ecosystem services, or natural climate solutions, if you will, are very important to reducing climate change, enhanced risk, and promoting resilience in local communities. And just yesterday, the National Academy of Sciences released a new report that says you can actually now predict changes in extreme weather events based on climate change. So for example, the California drought is 40% worse because of climate change. So this issue of climate weather is continually being researched, and we're finding that there is that nexus as well. So there are many climate change magnified risks that California has faced historically, and many of these risks can be mitigated to some extent through natural climate solutions. So we all know about wildfire. We know that thinning the forest can have an impact on fire behavior. Coastal erosion and sea level rise, exacerbated by climate change, obviously. But there, wetland protection, wetland restoration can help reduce those risks. Flooding down here in the bottom left, the levee breach, you know. So one of the very novel ideas that's being experimented with is to flood farm fields in the Delta to grow tulip plants to stop subsidence, increase carbon sequestration, and put pressure on the levees to help maintain them. Repairing restoration can help deal with floods. And the fifth area here that I want to emphasize that's not on the chart here, on the pictures, is what happens in our cities from high heat. We know now that climate change is increasing the risk of high heat and urban mortality. And we also know that planting trees and having green space is one strategy that's very effective at reducing high heat and providing, again, a suite of multiple benefits. So we at the Nature Conservancy looked at natural, what we were calling then natural infrastructure, which today is called natural climate solutions. And we did a case study report, and we found that in California, natural infrastructure is shown to be proven, it's cost effective, it's flexible, it allows you to make changes in the future, it's popular with people. You often get, like in Napa, a wonderful recreation area alongside their flood control project, and it provides a suite of multi-benefits. And I brought an index card that has the web link for this report if you'd like to see it. So we know that natural climate solutions are working to reduce risk. And I'm pleased to report that in collaboration with you, the local government commission, and several other stakeholders, we worked last year to secure passage of three bills that Governor Brown signed that create a policy platform, an architecture for climate resilience in California at the state, the regional, and the local scale. And one of the bills I want to call attention to is this bill, SB 379. Because if you're not familiar with it, you will be soon. It requires, it is law now, it requires that counties and others that do general plans that have a safety element, that you update the safety element of that plan at the next round, or you update your local hazard mitigation plan to include considerations of climate change. So this is a policy mechanism that directly links climate change to local planning and gives you an opportunity to look at integrating these natural climate solutions that I've been talking about into your local jurisdiction. But how do you pay for that? That's the challenge I've been asked to talk about here. So a great example, this is hopefully not a one-off, but Tuolumne County and the state of California, working with Tuolumne County, just received $40 million for a climate resiliency project for the Rim Fire. So I'm moving along here. So so the policy platform. So quickly here, there are two revenue streams around carbon that are already exist related to AB 32. The first is the AB 32 compliance offset program. It includes offsets for forest management and forest protection. There's also a protocol for urban forests that I know Santa Monica has been pursuing for a while. There's one on ozone depleting substances and a couple on methane capture. The state of California has approved 14 million metric tons of offsets. About half of that, almost half, 6 million metric tons were submitted in the first compliance period by regulated entities. The offsets are trading somewhere between $8 and $10 a ton. So if there's $4 million tons of offsets at $10 a ton, that's $40 million. If there's 14 million tons in the system, that's $140 million that are out there being actively in an active market. Now the other key funding source is the Greenhouse Gas Reduction Fund. The Greenhouse Gas Reduction Fund is created from the auction of permits. So every entity in the cap and trade program has to have a permit for every ton they emit. They can use offsets for up to 8% of their compliance obligation. The rest have to be compensated for with allowance permits. These are auctioned off quarterly. It's generating billions of dollars for the state. It was unplanned for when the law was written. It's quite ironic, and I can talk more about that later. But right now, in the governor's budget this year, proposed budget, there's $3.1 billion proposed to be spent from the Greenhouse Gas Reduction Fund. It has to be spent for activities that reduce greenhouse gas emissions. There's a suite of programs around transportation, transit-oriented development, low-income housing, that would be, I'm sure, a very interest to all of you and available to you. I'm going to focus here on the portion that is earmarked for natural resources, or what they call the natural and working land sector. There are six different programs that are run by six different agencies. Some have been in place for 2 years, some are brand new. The total is $355 million available here. And so one of those is the Sustainable Agricultural Land Conservation Program at the Strategic Growth Council. It'll have $40 million again this year. Most of the money is available for conservation easements, and a small portion is available for planting. But this is something that David can serve and check out. The Department of Forestry and Fire Protection is slated to get $150 million this year to do fire risk reduction if they can do it in a way that has an effective carbon accounting mechanism. There's also money for forest conservation, forest legacy program as well. And then two departments, the Department of Forestry and the Natural Resources Agency, will split $50 million on urban forestry and urban greening. So the urban forestry is what's happening with the Department of Forestry. It's an old program. It's been going on for a long time. So last year there was $30 million for this, and they funded 30 projects, and they had more proposals than they could meet. And then the urban greening is a new $20 million pot. We'll see how that is expanded, but it does earmark pocket parks and green space and parkways and things other than just the street tree planting. So another pot of money will be available for wetlands and meadows. It was last year. This year, $60 million. They've increased it, and they've added desert ecosystems as well. So projects that can show a reduction in greenhouse gases or an increase in carbon storage are eligible to apply for those projects, and governments can apply, and I'm running out of money. So, and then yet another, and this is a new program, Climate Smart Agriculture. So I know gentlemen talked about biochar, and there's a new Healthy Soils Initiative that's being put together where that could fit into this. It's administered by the Department of Food and Agriculture. So you see there's a suite of programs with money to be had for projects that can show reducing greenhouse gases or storing more carbon. Methodologies are different. So what I wanted to do in the brief time left, is show you a little bit about what we've been doing in Sonoma County to develop a method to account for changes in carbon from land use change. So there's a lot of work done on transportation, a lot of work done on industrial facilities, but how do you actually measure changes in carbon on the land base in a way that can make you eligible for these funds? And so we did this project, which was 3.5 years in the making. And again, in another advertisement here, I do have a card that has the link for this. I do have a few hard copies. If you want an actual hard copy and put a little weight in the back of your car because it's snowy, you can do that as well. So this is a first of its kind project. We did it with the Sonoma County Agricultural Preservation and Open Space District. Thank you. A great partner to work with. So we developed an accounting framework to account for changes in greenhouse gases, or carbon, if you will, at the county scale. So the offsets that I talked to you about are done at a project scale, and then this is a scale up. It's what we call in the international forestry realm a jurisdictional scale. So it can be, in this case, a county. And then we added a conservation values assessment, very similar to what David did. It looked at different features and values that are natural resource oriented and also ecosystem service oriented. And by doing this, you can integrate with state and local policies like your climate action plans, the greenhouse gas fund, and so forth. So what are the key, quickly, the elements? So you do a carbon inventory by land type. So you're looking at forests, oak woodlands, shrubs. Eventually we got to urban forests. And then we did it over a 20-year time frame and projected a baseline. What would happen? This is sort of what would happen without intervention. But then we integrated a conservation values assessment, and we built it to a model and ran the model with alternative scenarios similar to the way that David did. So what we found here is that, in fact, in Sonoma County, carbon is growing, so the trend line is up. And primarily, this is because of the very carbon-rich redwood forest. But in the upper right, you can see a loss there that came from a large fire. And in the central area along the 101 corridor, you see emissions from the conversion of ranch land or open space land, grassland or forest land, into developed land.
as well. So overall, 750,000 tons are being sequestered annually.
So there's a growth rate there. So then in the conservation value assessment, we took some themes. We took food production, water supply, biodiversity, and eventually we added urban forests. Similar again to what David talked about. And the components we looked at were integrated crop and rangelands, the headwater stream quality, groundwater recharge potential, and then level of human disturbance or connectivity really for biodiversity. We mapped all these, put them in a tool, and said, okay, if you want to maximize for these with carbon, you know, how do you make these trade-offs? How do you evaluate one against the other? And so this is just one example. This is an example of just one scenario. So in this scenario, we said, okay, we're going to limit the conversion of forest land and oak woodland. Say a certain percentage will not be converted. And you can do this spatially. You can figure out what places to do. And then we said, okay, we're going to improve conifer forest management in certain places. And then we're going to restore riparian and valley oak areas. And you can see the results here. It's about 15 million tons of greenhouse gas benefits. So at $10 a ton, that could be $150 million, roughly. But so this kind of analysis shows that, in fact, it's proof of concept that you can quantify greenhouse gas reductions from the land base. You can actually reduce those greenhouse gas reductions by changes in land use and land management. And you can achieve conservation values at the same place, at the same point in time. And this methodology, we believe, is applicable broadly. We'd like to talk to Placer County. We're talking to the state of California. And on March 23rd, the state of California will have a public workshop on how to integrate natural and working lands into the AB 32 implementation plan. They call it the scoping plan. So we're hoping that the state can get it together to do this kind of analysis. Spatial analysis, statewide scale, so we can see the real role that natural working lands play in the climate scene in California. So in conclusion, natural climate solutions are essential to maintaining healthy, natural and human communities. They provide a suite of benefits. And by doing this, we need to do this to address climate change. We need to capture these benefits from the land base in order to succeed. And I, again, would encourage you to do this at the local level, to look at your general plans, which is going to come up under the Jackson bill, to look at your climate action plans, to look at other incentives, policies, and programs you have at the local level, and work to see how you can integrate natural climate solutions to reduce risk, enhance resilience, and help fight climate change. And the benefit is that you will capture the ecosystem services that nature provides and all of the multiple benefits that are available. And so to me, I think this is a great opportunity for all of us. There is money on the table now. It's beginning and it's really a great opportunity. It's a great exciting time to be doing this work here in this state, leading the world. The challenge is ours. What kind of legacy will we leave? Will we act swiftly enough and with enough impact that we leave a planet that in some way resembles that with which we grew up with? Thank you.